lovely to see such wonderfully happy faces and people who have supported us over so many years through COVID of this book club. And I think our librarian, Shibunti, will bear me out if I say that this is our rocking 38th book club meet, which means we've been in business with you and the members of the Bengal Club, on behalf of whom I welcome you. When Sushruta and Mona of Ahava Communications handed me this book, I said, another one. I've just done two reviews for my favorite newspaper in the city, which is The Telegraph. And one was on Alice Munro, who was the Canadian diva, and she won the Nobel Prize. She was 92, and I said, I can't get away from this. I have to do her. And then arrived Philip's book on my table. I'm so grateful, Mona and Sushruta, because it really has resonated me to the point of driving me to tears. That takes a lot for someone who's doing two, sometimes one review a week. I think you will all hear from me and all of us. There's Oindrila here and there's Harish here. Some of us, like Harish and I, have lived in Philip George's background, the author's background, and his co-author Geeta K, who I'm very pleased to meet. So without further ado, let me hand it over to Mona Sengupta to do the honors. Thank you, Mona.
Very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and a very, very warm welcome to our chief guest this evening, the Consul General of Russia, His Excellency Alexei M. Idamin. Thank you so much, sir, for being here with us. Sush, can you please felicitate him? Thank you, Dr. Mehta, for inviting him on behalf of the Bengal Club for this very prestigious book launch. Before I go on, ladies and gentlemen, I will really appreciate it if you could kindly put your cell phones on silent mode. Thank you. So we have gathered this evening, along with a very, very distinguished panel, as you can see, for the launch of the book, Racket Boy, Where is My Country? Yatra of a Clueless Immigrant, written by Philip George, along with Geeta K. Ladies and gentlemen, everybody on the panel is so distinguished, but I've been asked to do a very brief intro of each of them. So without further ado, I shall do so. So we start with our author, Philip George. Leaving Malaysia after high school, Philip George made his own path in England for over four decades before embracing Italy in retirement to create more stories from San Romaro, his village in the mountains of Tuscany. Before becoming a solicitor of the Supreme Court of England and Wales, Philip hustled through a range of jobs, such as factory worker, psychiatric nurse, banker, stevedore, and more. An avid fan of many sports, he completed 25 marathons, pedaled extensively and attended three World Cups, three Olympics, three Commonwealth Games, several Formula One races, and for good measure, one Royal Ascot. He is the member of the Court Arbitration for Sports, headquartered in Switzerland. Philip currently extends his legal wisdom pro bono and conducts life coaching clinics. Ladies and gentlemen, all the way from Italy, Kolkata, please welcome him warmly, Philip George. Sush, can you please felicitate Philip George?
Thank you so much for being in Kolkata.
His co-author, Geeta K., a third-generation Malaysian, Geeta K. was born in the coastal town of Port Dickson and raised in Kuala Lumpur's fringes. An educator for two decades, she began as a language teacher in the private sector, rising to the position of department head. She then moved her commitment to her other passion of writing, which led to her foray into the media business. To date, she writes and edits for independent media outlets, mainly on social and lifestyle issues. Geeta has successfully concluded a niche masterclass in memoir writing in London, conducted by a leading English daily and university. She is the author of two novels, including the one that will be discussed this evening, and is about to publish her third. Ladies and gentlemen, from Malaysia, co-author of the book to be discussed, Geeta K., please welcome her warmly. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am, for being here. Oindrila Dutt, such a familiar face in Kolkata, in print, at events. She is one of the leading veterans as a curator and presenter, having presented events at different heritage venues and having worked with luminaries across the world. And she's also an author, a columnist, and has founded Open Doors. And today we stand here at Ahava because of all that she's done for us for the last 12 years, unselfishly. Ladies and gentlemen, give it a round for Miss Oindrila Dutt. Thank you, Oindrila. Thank you so much for being part of our journey. Dr. Harish Mehta has taught at McMaster University of Toronto and Trent University in Canada, courses such as the Vietnam Wars, US Foreign Relations since 1898, World History up to 1800, World History from 1800 to the present, History of Southeast Asia and Human Rights, and so on. He is a distinguished personality, ladies and gentlemen. He is known worldwide as a journalist, as a writer, as a commentator, as a thinker. And to top it all, Dr. Mehta won the Asian Media Print Award in 1998 for his research paper on Cambodia. The award was given to him at a ceremony presided by the then Prime Minister Anwar Ibrahim in Kuala Lumpur. Ladies and gentlemen, we are so honored to have this very distinguished academic and intellectual, Dr. Mehta. Ladies and gentlemen, this is his home club, but please welcome him. Thank you, Dr. Mehta, for your time. And the moderator, I know she's family, but you got to do the honors. Dr. Julie Mehta, our moderator this evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks to her, we are hosting this event at the prestigious Bengal Club. She's a Loreto girl. She has done her PhD and her double masters in Canada. She has taught at Toronto. She's a columnist with the T2. She's an author, and she's currently professor of literature for MA classes at Loreto College. I will not take much of your time by going into details because we all know her so well. So, ladies and gentlemen, for our moderator this evening, Dr. Julie Banerjee Mehta. Thank you so much, Julidi. This event is happening because of all your hard work. And ladies and gentlemen, enjoy the evening, have a wonderful time, and we look forward with all enthusiasm to the next 50 minutes of discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you for that glorious launch of this evening, Mona, and all your kind words to everyone.
Before the moderator goes on, I'm so sorry, Julidi. I request all the panelists and our chief guest this evening to please come and formally launch the book. Please, sir, please come. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the formal launch of Racket Boy. Where is my country? Yatra of a clueless immigrant. Ladies and gentlemen, please congratulate the two distinguished authors. It's a great moment for him in Kolkata. Thank you so much. Yes, Julidi, all yours.
We have a video to play, so I will say a few words and we will just go straight in to the streaming of the images. Very quickly, those of you who know the issue of the diaspora will understand why I am so moved by this book. It's because you never really find a home. When you have many homes, when you're in one home, you think of the other one. When you're in the other home, you think of another one. So we're basically homeless people. That resonated with me so deeply. The credit goes to both George and to Geeta. Because when George is telling his story, what is remarkable about this book is that Geeta has captured the voice, and the voice never wavers. It's George Philip speaking all the way. There are no troughs, there are no dissents, it's very even. You're hooked. You're hooked because you hear the story of a schoolboy who grew up in Malaysia in a rubber plantation, but it could be any young boy anywhere in the world. It has a universality. And honestly, within the first 40 pages, to get a dragon like me, who's been in this business of literature, teaching it, reading, criticizing for a very long time, I was in tears last night, within the first 40 pages. Because what Philip George did to me was retell the story of my brother, who was very promising in Calcutta. His friends thought that, okay, my parents were wealthy enough or encouraging enough to send him to Tampa, to Florida, because he had a future in tennis. But the limitations were that they didn't want my brother Ranjun to go that hard way with no guarantees. They thought that if he got the degrees, it would be guaranteed that he'd get a cushy life. And I knew that Ranjun had it very hard to stomach that. Who knows if he had the financial support for 10 years, who knows? Maybe he wouldn't have made a name in the tennis world. First point. Second point about the book, which really shook me, was that Philip George and Geeta must have had some sort of understanding. We'll talk to them later, so we know the secrets, but must have had some sort of understanding to be on top of literary theory which we teach and we try for our graduate students in North America and in India to grasp. And what is that literary theory? When you're writing a book in post-colonial, in the post-colonial worldview, the latest trend is you say to the English reader, look, you like it or you don't. We're not going to give you the meanings of each Malay word. And that's exactly what they've done. The interesting word limau manis and the idea of being in school in Kajang, all the invectives that were suffered by Philip because he was not interested so much in his studies, but he was an ace badminton player from Gitko. So the two things that they do together very well in the book is to keep that indigenous Malay tongue and give us the flavor and the color of Malaysia. You will find that the chutneyfication in Malaysia and in Singapore comes through in the book right in the beginning, because it is Philip George's mother's Kerala-based fish curry, prawn curry, that you can almost smell. You can smell the mee siam, you can smell the rojak, you can smell laksa, roti john. And food becomes a pathway through which culture is excavated, even in the parts where they talk about Lancaster, they talk about England, they talk about the pub. And his first meal, most unfortunately, because the cousin he was supposed to move into his home, Mr. Cherian, wasn't a very generous fellow. And we know many relatives like that when we send children or we go ourselves. You know, there's a lot of hype. He's doing so well. But he actually lives in the basement. Or he's not really ready to spend a sou on you. So his first meal of the tuna sandwich. These are recollections that are so real that they speak to us. About the plot and the story, I will not be a spoiler. I will let this evening open the doors, unpackage the book, and hope you will all jump in when we have time for our conversation with you and the author. So with that, may I first request Philip to open those magic doors to us, and then Geeta for about 5 minutes each, and then I'll do a round robin with Harish and Oindrila giving their spin-offs on what appealed to them about this book, why it matters not just to Asia, not just because it's the story of a boy who was self-made man today, who is a name in sports circles, who's made an effective story about himself, kicking all the criticism away and making it on his own, but also because it will instill the inspiration in kids all over the world not to be undergirded by parental authority, but to break free when they want. So would you like me to first give you both a voice and then show the video? What do you want to do?
Seems like yesterday, but it was long ago. Jane, it was lovely, she was the queen of my night. There in the darkness with the radio playing low, and the secrets that we shared, the mountains that we moved, left to burn and nothing left to prove. And I remember what she said to me, how she swore that it never would end. I remember how she held me oh so tight. Wish I didn't know now what I didn't know then. Against the wind, we were young and strong. We were running against the wind. And the years rolled slowly past, and I found myself alone, surrounded by strangers I thought were my friends. Found myself further and further from my home, and I guess I lost my way. There were oh so many roads. I was living to run and running to live. Never worried about paying or even how much I owed. Moving 8 miles a minute for months at a time. Myself searching, searching for shelter again and again. Against the wind, little something against the wind. I found myself seeking shelter again.
Everybody, thank you so much for you all coming today. It's very overpowering to be in this colonial club, because places like these were, what's the word I shall use, deprived, prohibited, and when I was in Malaysia, this was the place the Europeans attended. So to be here is very, very, I don't know what to say. It's very
unreal.
That's and nostalgic. So thank you all so much. The story, I don't think I have to say anything further, because you can overload a story. It's all been already said. And the synopsis was there, it was presented in the Frankfurt Book Fair, and we're very pleased with that. And the book came about because my neighbor in England was a professor, he was the world's leading authority, a guy called Professor Ray Haslam. He was my neighbor in a stately home in England where I lived, next door to him. And he was fascinated with my life of rushing around everywhere, not staying still, as my father would say. And over a glass of red wine, which we used to have virtually every evening, a good conversation emanated from that. And he said, "Phil, you should write a book." I said, what book? "You have a tremendous story." I said, "I have nothing to say." So he kept pestering me with his wife, and then I was so busy with whatever I was doing, and then came COVID, and I thought, well, everything in Tuscany closed, as everywhere in the world. I thought, don't waste a good crisis. And I got down to thinking about the book, and then I made a a WhatsApp message to a friend of mine in Kuala Lumpur, who we grew up in the rubber estates. And he was connected to Guy there by, they were relatives. And we were put in touch. And she's been gift-wrapped and sent from heaven. And the book then developed. And I was just the storyteller. So everything you see in the book is credit to Gita. So that's all I wish to say at this stage.
I was thinking of how to start today. As Phil and I were meandering through the floods, the flash floods, after the rains today. And we were actually thinking, oh no, you know, this is going to affect the numbers coming today. You know, is anybody going to be there? kind of thing, you know, because it happens in quite frequently during the monsoon season in Kuala Lumpur, where I come from as well. And then sprang this idea, said, I thought to myself, okay, sorry, I'm getting a bit emotional. I mean, how not to be with a stupendous introduction like Julie just gave us? You know, I'm still stupefied, absolutely. So you guys will have to supply us with the vocabulary to continue, if at all we are going to speak.
You're not the only one. So you're okay.
Yeah, but we are not used to this. I mean, you guys are the professionals. I mean, it feels like I'm in the company of doyens here of Calcutta. So going back, this idea just sprang to me. I just want to say, sisters and brothers of Bengal, thank you for turning up for us this evening. I don't have to tell you who that reference is to. But I just want to share a small link to this people, as in you, because it has a major contribution to this book and my journey with Phil the past 3 years. In 2004, a book came to me, not what I would ordinarily read. It was by Paramahamsa Yogananda, called Autobiography of a Yogi. Came to me when I was pregnant. And it was such a heavy read. I wasn't prepared for something like that. And I didn't know what he was talking about beyond Kriya Yoga. So I did not know the writer was actually talking about a personality, because it just came to my office and somebody said, you know, this book, would you like to take it? You know, nobody wants it, you know, would you like it? So I just took it home and I went through about 4 or 5 chapters and I gave it up because it was just too deep for me at that point. Obviously, I was not ready for it, but I was so struck by the word Kriya. And so when I delivered a baby girl, it was the first thing I told my husband. She's Kriya, right? And then 1 month before her 6th birthday, Kriya left us. She died in India. And so I've lived with that vicious conundrum. What do I do about India? You know? I can hate it. I can continue as I am. Or, well, I'm inherently a very happy person. I think some of you would have noticed, you know, I just am. Yeah? So when I was able to quickly tell myself, no, I'm not going south. It's just not me. Yeah? So, I sought relief and solace from my laptop post that. Yeah, because suddenly in my life I was asking big questions, yeah, from this Yahoo, fairly young person at the time. I was suddenly asking big questions. Who the hell am I? Where do I get this strength? Like, I was able to, you know, just tell myself, you know, where was this little girl 35 years ago? I had her at 36. And 6 years later, she's left me, all right? There was a time when you were not with me, and I did fairly well. You're gone. and I know I can do well as well. But who are you? Who am I? The sort of questions were questions that I never thought I would be asking myself. So in the 30 days after she left, I resurrected Autobiography of a Yogi. Still in the library, I thought we might have given it away, but no, it was still there. I went back and I finished the book in about 2 or 3 weeks. I still won't claim I understand it completely. I don't think I ever will. Yeah, but it began to make a bit more sense. The more it made sense to me, the more I realized, all right, perhaps I'm on a track. I'm on a track, I'm on a trail. And then I went back to my laptop and did a word count, and I realized I'd written about 40,000 words. And I did a Google again, and Google said 40,000 is a novella, a mini novel. And I told myself, if I can write a novella, you can do a novel. Yep, but I don't do things by halves, so I thought I would train myself in something, in some field, and turn the 40,000 that I'd written into something of publishable quality. Yeah, so that people in similar situation could perhaps learn or pick up something from what I'd gone through. And so I know it sounds very bombastic now, woo, me wanting to. It was not about teaching or anything, it was just a lot of things that I had. It was a lot of outpourings, right? So I thought I could turn that into something of publishable quality. Long story short, I applied to this memoir writing course in London. I packed off, went for 6 months, did the course, came back. And my first book was a few years later. I waited until 2018. About 4 years later came this big landmark general election in my country when, after 60 years, the only ruling party was finally toppled. And eventually, the current prime minister took over, Mr. Anwar Ibrahim, as Professor was talking about earlier. So I took that opportunity and I wrote a novel based on the parliamentary constituency where I come from. So it's fiction, but it is sort of fiction, non-fiction. Yeah, that came out. But I was still in a little bit of a quandary because, you know, I felt like I was still wasting my training. I trained to become a memoir writer, to write about people's lives. But of course, I came back feeling that small. Who the hell wants to read my story? Yeah. So I aborted that idea. I wrote a novel. Novel comes out. 1 year later, I had a call from my cousin saying, da-da-da-da-da, Philip George, and he only wants a Malaysian writer. Yeah, are you interested? Why wouldn't I be interested? Yeah, I will make it very simple. Why I decided to pursue this, because I was well aware of the difficulties of adopting another person's voice, becoming another person in order to produce the kind of product that your subject wants. So a lot of compromises needed to be made, and I knew the intimacy of the process as well. So would I want to do it? Yeah. So long story short, my cousin made that introduction, and he passed me Phil's number. Phil calls me, sending me a WhatsApp message saying, this will be a short call, and let's see how it works. So a short call of what was to have been 30 minutes ended up being approximately 7 hours. Yeah. So that should tell you about the intensity of that conversation. The more this man spoke, I realized that he spoke with a sense of story, you know, and I immediately knew that his stories needed to be told, with the same simplicity that he was talking about. I think that is what I wanted to share with you today. Thank you.
Absolutely stunning. Thank you for that, Geeta. Harish, would you like to say a few words about your reaction to the book and how you connected to your experience in Malaysia? I would like very much if we could keep the responses to about 3 minutes so we can keep coming back. Okay.
Well, thank you for this book, Philip and Geeta. It's very readable, and it sparked in me as a reader thoughts about growing up. It's a growing up book in some respects. At least the first 180 to 200 pages is about growing up, and in the sense of being the a Bildungsroman, as the literature buffs would call it, the story of growing up. And that story is so universal, you know, that Philip comes from Prang Besar, a small plantation town, works his way around all the way to England. Consul General Alexia Dumkin comes out of Moscow and finds himself in Calcutta, where he's been for several years. I found myself coming from Lucknow to Bombay to Dubai to Singapore, Bangkok, and then to Canada, and then back here. And so it's about, you know, all of us in a sense are looking for home, as Julie pointed out. Home and belonging, where do we really belong? And the fact of the matter is that you belong wherever you are. So, you know, the years when I was in Singapore, I was totally there. I was totally there. And Malaysia, in many ways, was our other home. So we used to travel there very often, to the very places that our authors are from. You know, Georgetown, Penang, Desaru, Malacca, KL, Genting Highlands. You know, our visits to the Selangor Club. The Selangor Club is an institution which the author talks about as being a colonial setup where he would go to celebrate with his friends. I just wanted to also in the beginning sort of compare his growing up years in Malaysia to some of the other literature that exists. Any reader will be reminded of, in some wisps of the works of Somerset Maugham. You will possibly even think about George Orwell's Eastern work. You'll certainly think of the current novelist called Tan Thuan Eng, who's a pretty good writer himself. It's a book that will fill you with nostalgia. Nostalgia not for Malaysia necessarily, but it did fill me with nostalgia for Southeast Asia, because there were so many things that were in the book, from food to places, that reminded me of film nostalgia. It'll fill the general reader with nostalgia because it forces you to engage with yourself. Who are you? Because the story of growing up is so universal. One of the things that struck me in the book was the colonial divide. The spaces where Philip and his father and mother and siblings lived were separate spaces carved away from the living spaces of the white colonial masters. You know, the plantation owners were all English. They lived in their own areas, whereas the employees all had their own townships, or they lived away. And then the workers, the hard laborers, Philip's father was a manager, but the hard laborers, being the Malay and the Indian, the semi-educated, semi-literate persons, they would live in kampongs, which were, kampongs are like little villages, Julie's going to be after me to race through this like a kampong chicken. So I'd better get my act together. Now, one of the things I noticed was he doesn't mention nasi biryani while he mentions many of the food items. I couldn't find nasi biryani. Nasi biryani is what we call biryani. But nasi means rice, and they turn biryani into biryani. It tastes quite different, but it's lovely. It's especially the Malay version of the nasi biryani.
Dr. Mehta, can we just...
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you. Oindrila Dotto, who's really been a terrific force in this city, as many of you know. Art, literature, whatever. Very well-traveled lady. And my connection to her is what I'm very proud about. She and I go back to our...
Nursery.
Wow.
And I could hear Anu, I see Anu and Aparna nodding. I wouldn't like them to talk about what kind of force I am. But to get back to something that Harish said, you know, growing up, a lot of this book, it starts from school, his school days in Malaysia. And I think the residual message that this book leaves with one, and I'm sure maybe you intended it to be that way, Philip, is one of hope. One of hope and being able to surmount old odds and fight it out to be a success even when the world thinks that you cannot succeed. Good enough to climb a coconut tree. But that young lad who was good enough only to climb a coconut tree went on to many careers, as you saw there, but was offered a partnership, became a partner in the solicitor's firm, was going to become a judge when it all got to be too much for him and he changed. I won't go into the details. But it's a tremendous story of hope, resilience, a message to everyone who thinks that I'm not good enough because their Asian parents are egging them on to study and achieve, not to achieve in other ways. I think one of the great things that you think about when you think of America, US, is that it's such a land of opportunity. And a carpenter or a guitarist gets as much respect as any high-level scientist, lawyer, or teacher, academic. And that is something that I think Philip shows through his book. It's a wonderful message. To go back to South Asia, there is so much that is reminiscent of what we've grown up with. We've known the people in this book. Villages, communities, relatives who want to be in your hair. Who's that girl he's come home with? Why is he looking different, dressing different, talking about it? Has he done well? One failure and they're ready to pounce on you. We've all been through that. But somewhere, there's also a sense of reassurance. We've grown up like that. I'm going to be jumping from topic to topic because these are straight-off reactions from the top of my head. One of the things that struck me is, it happened before, very rarely, I don't know, maybe Julie will agree with me, parents were tough. Your relationship with your parents was far more demanding. If they said, this is what you do, you did it. Things are very different now. And I think, in a way, maybe there was some merit to it. There was a lot more discipline. There were many more boundaries. But in a way, that encouragement, the fact that a mother and father could say to their child that, you know, you really matter to me. We love you no matter what you do, whether you fail or not. That also is a wonderful message that you think of in this book. Because so often Philip George says, why couldn't that man, my father, just tell me once that you've done good, you've done well? Why couldn't he appreciate me? And that is a very poignant thing that comes out of this book, something that I thought. You know, I'm just going to read two lines from the introduction. He says here, I just went along like a nowhere man with the world at my command. And sometime if I get a chance, I'll come back to that nowhere man. And
I slowly learned to be the sponge, to absorb everything, to open my mouth, although it was very difficult, and never let failures and setbacks pull me down for too long. That is the essence of his book. It's a wonderful mishmash, not just of Southeast Asia, South Asia. Harish talked about food. There's, of course, iced kachang, there's laksa, there are so many things that we are familiar with. And there are the sights and smells, the Kerala coconut curries, the railway stations, the bus rides. But also at the other end, when he goes to the continent, getting used to that, having the belief in himself, even though sometimes there were doubts, that how am I going to make it? But to have that confidence, in large measure because of your sporting activity, your prowess, that I can meet them head on, one to one, and be a success and be accepted, that is a wonderful story. And to see where that takes him, across continents, across committees, clubs, bastions that he could never have otherwise hoped to storm, and he does. So really for me, this is a wonderful story of hope and resilience that sends out a message to so many.
Wonderful. Very right. Very, very true. It's on point. And I think it brings, it opens my doors to ask my question to George and to Philip and to Geeta. Now, there are parts in the book which are absolutely so compelling because those of us who have children that we've sent first generation now to the West, or those of us who've studied in the West, are very used to this experience of bird whistles. You can't place your towel here. That's ungentlemanly behavior. But at the same time, Philip, you so generously point out that there were also Englishmen like Sims who gave you that wonderful new job offer. And the humor that you bring into this book with Mr. Sim, the Chota Saab, having a splendid, resplendent affair with another Mem Saab when the wife is not in the house. You know, it is these little patakas, as we say, you know, these little bursts that create a very readable, if you look at it from the literary point of view, and I have no doubt that Geeta had a lot to do with that. For instance, page 199, and I say this because you would think that, oh, she's talking off the top of her hat. I'm not. It actually is in the book. The cow milked to death, then banished to the slaughterhouse. He's talking about taking every bit of treasure out of India and then forget it. So I wanted to ask Philip, he's had a slew of experiences that have been some good, some really bad, about race relations, and yet he had a man like Jeffrey Knowles who mentored him like a son and made him partly what he is today. So I would like you to comment on that, Philip. What would be your last few sentences to us about race today in the world?
When you told me about bird whistle, my mind raced straight away to Sunil Gavaskar. That incident, the test match, I think it was in England, John Snow, I think you all know about it, was bowling, and Gavaskar had hit a four, or he was going to the boundary, but he wasn't sure the ball had reached the boundary, so he was doing his running between the wickets. And John Snow, can you believe it? He was a preacher's son from Hampshire. It's a home county, one of those posh counties. probably a public school boy as well, couldn't hack it. He went and knocked Gavaskar and floored him. And it was an international event. I was only 19, and I was doing my mental nursing, and I watched it live on BBC. And I thought, this is horrendous. And the commentator saying, these sort of things happen. Whereas if it had been reverse, it would have been a World War III. So that's the dichotomy of what I was facing. So when Bert Whistle took my towel away, I was tongue-tied. The white man is superior to me. So I didn't know what to do. I just had to think of my Chinese coach, who was my mentor in Malaya, who taught me how to meditate with a candle after training. I was sponsored by Shell at the age of 9 in Malaya for badminton. So we would train for 2 hours, then we have a shower. The shower would be in a little bathroom somewhere. We were very proud of our privacy. So I'll tell you a story about that shortly. After the training, we would go into a dark room with a candle, and he would give us different objects, different days. So I'd have a pencil, and I had to concentrate for 15 minutes on this pencil. It's to get in the zone. Athletes will tell you. It's every point at a time. So if you're playing cricket, you know, your run is zero. Get the first run, second. Don't think of the 100. Don't even think of 20. So it's keeping in the zone. So this book is all about keeping in the zone. And keeping in the zone comes... Sorry, I'm getting quiet. Comes from my mother, you know, because she said, if you do something, do it properly. So going back to Bert Whistle, which makes it much easier to talk about than my mother. So I had to swallow it. So I had to come through that crisis. So you've seen that in tennis, you've seen that in all sports where an athlete takes a dip. And I often look now how he is going to recover. The recovery is the most important thing. And you've got that in Nadal, Djokovic, Lionel Messi, Lewis Hamilton. When the chips are down is when the tough get going. I lived there for 47 years, so I'm acquiring all this stuff because it's such wonderful journalism, exposure, and also they allow you to roam around England. So I was able, this stupid boy was able to roam around. You know, and then just because I was good at badminton, they took me into the inner sanctum. That's impossible for people to get. So I got into girlfriends, music, rock music, drinking, not excessively, drug taking. I didn't touch it. My friends did. So again, I had a discipline not to go there because my sport was important. Because I had commitments. I was playing county. I was playing tournaments from September till April. Every weekend, I would be playing a county tournament like Leicestershire Open, Lancashire Open, Yorkshire Open, Middlesex, Surrey. So I had commitments. And so going back to Bert Whistle, somehow I managed to hold myself. I lost that game, and I was playing the England's junior champion, who was protected by the Indian Cricket Board. So he's an up-and-coming Indian star being bowled out by some guy from Karnataka who is unknown. So I was in a similar situation. They didn't know me. So I had to come through that. I'd hitchhiked to that tournament. You know, and then I lost the second game, and then I won the third game. And then that was in the quarterfinals, semifinals, I won. the finals I won. And Bert Whistle, who was a larger-than-life character, he umpired Jimmy Connors against some guy in Wimbledon. So he's a colonial type. He would be very comfortable here. And you'll all be worshipping him. So he's that type of guy here. And he had to present me with a cup. And that limp handshake, that no respect for me. All I remember now is that limp. It's in the book. That limp handshake. But, you know, I was optimistic, just get on with it. You know, enjoying life. And so I didn't attach a great deal to it. I had the trophy. And then, talking about racism, that match, the singles, finished at midnight, cold winter's night. Yes. The buses had all stopped. I had to hitchhike from Lytham St. Anne's to Preston, a distance of about 60 kilometers. I had a trophy wrapped up in a towel, and I got a lift, and then I'm waiting for my next one while I'm walking. A police car, a panda car they used to call it, which was, I used to see it on BBC TV, stopped me. And they thought I'd stolen the silverware. So I had to explain myself. Anyway, they were fine. And they let me go. So it's instances like that, which gives you the grounding. The grounding of life. And there are so many stuff like that. What about
the story? I mean, that really sticks in my mind. Because it's actually happened with a friend who I went grocery shopping with in Toronto. You remember that story? Mm-hmm. Do you want to tell it?
Yeah, I'm a fitness freak. So I go running every day. In fact, today I ran around Calcutta 6 kilometers this morning. So I was married then. And the Wimbledon ladies final, Martina Navratilova and Chrissy Evert was on finals. So I'd run 18 miles, which is 35 kilometers. Just a normal Saturday run. I was unruffled and shaven. And she said, before you come up, why don't I come down? We go shopping to Sainsbury's, which is a supermarket in England. And I said, okay. She came down. I put a jacket on or a fleece or something. And I hate going shopping. So I had a trolley. She was filling the trolley. And I saw two policemen coming towards us. I think they were coming to investigate something. And one of the guys happened to look at me. I was the only colored person. Where I lived in Lancashire, which is near the Lake District, often I would be the only brown guy. This is totally different to London, Bradford, Wolverhampton, Birmingham, and all these places, Southall, where the Indians congregate. So all your students, they all tend to go there. So I'm in a different place altogether. I'm in the real hard cowboy country, but very sophisticated. So I had to, and by that time I was already a lawyer, and I was in the Rotary, in the Morecambe Golf Club, you know, in the Lord's Cricket Ground I was a member, and Old Trafford Cricket Ground. So, you know, I was quite high profile. So to be suddenly accosted by this policeman, it says, what are you doing here? You've been banned for shoplifting. Because he misunderstood me. He did racial profiling. That's what we use. So he'd put one and one together, or it must be him. So I pull rank in front of about at least 1,000 people. It's a huge supermarket. And 70% would know me. Either as a lawyer, as a sportsperson, whatever, and other reputations. And so And they would say, no smoke without fire. These sort of things, you know. How do you overcome it? I was more embarrassed for my white wife, who was trembling and she was so angry. So we went to the police station to complain. Well, they, you know what they do, they just fill a few forms. But I wasn't going to let you rest. I took them to court and won substantial damages. So that this is what I do.
Philip, is it okay if Geeta reads out something and then you can do that and we'll have one more quick round robin?
Page 13, please, yes. Julie's asked me to read an excerpt from page 13 of the book, which is the first chapter, and it's called Freedom, because the book opens with five-year-old Phil watching our first prime minister declare Malaysia as an independent country. Union Jack comes down, and our flag goes up. So this is from page 13 of the first chapter. On report card signing day, I unfailingly ended up with parts of my body sore and discolored. My worst memory was the time when a fed-up class teacher who knew very well what I was up to with my I forgot, father was busy excuses, wrote a note for Papa and sent it through my friend and classmate, Rajivan. Heart beating in my ear, I watched Papa, stirred from his siesta by Rajivan's arrival, his bushy eyebrows twitching over his thick-rimmed black spectacles, glaring at the red marks on my report card. It triggered a tsunami, set off a stentorian Mohan, one of many storms of my school days. Mohan, by the way, is his Indian, Philip's Indian name. It was a societal norm to regard the Englishman as superior. Anyone who dared show nerve was inevitably put in their place, as my father would experience numerous times over the course of his career. The deference the English elicited from locals was carefully cultivated by the elite oligarchy living in secluded compounds with grass tennis courts, luxuriant gardens, trimmed lawns, servants, drivers, sentry posts with uniformed Gurkha security guards and pedigree Alsatians. Their social exclusivity meant we were not allowed anywhere near their compounds or to play with their children. It was much the same with the Indian workers, where factionalism kept those in supervisory and administrative roles segregated from menial laborers. We Malayali children were told the labor lines bordering a Hindu temple, toddy shop, and Tamil school were off limits. Ends.
The reason why I wanted you to hear this is because many things haven't changed. We have, all over Southeast Asia and in South Asia, gated communities. And there is this segregation, not just physical, but also of the mind. And I think if you take the equation a little further from race, it is also about privilege, status and money.
I just wanted to say that on the rubber plantation, Harish talked about the Englishmen, the Brits who managed it, and the Indians and where they stayed. But there were further divisions, the laborers who actually toiled, and their accommodation, which was a whole different ballgame.
And I think what appealed to us readers was the idea of the, he was called the red-hatted, what was the Malay word? Krani Topi Mera. Man, the clerk with the red hat. And what he did during his time where he was given a little empowerment, he put it to good use. He made sure these working Malay women had insurance, health insurance, and they had buses to bus them to their place of work, especially during the monsoons, and better working conditions where they would not be so used to getting snake bite or get sick. So I would like to congratulate you for that.
Thank you.
So Yeah, Dr.
Mehta,
3 minutes. And we will have 3 minutes. Thank you.
Yes,
yeah,
so
before people get restless, we'll pack it up.
So the author takes us through the changes he sees in both the physical and the social environment of Malaysia, of the plantation economy. As he grows up, he sees the raising of the kampungs, the raising of the villages, and there is some sense of loss he encounters because these were places he loved and these were places he used to crisscross on his bicycle the whole time. The other thing that was changes in the social economy, where he begins to find that there's discrimination at work, in that his father's employer was this man called McIntosh. And it turns out that his father now owns a better car than McIntosh. And he has habits that are a little more upmarket than McIntosh's habits. McIntosh doesn't seem to take too kindly to this.
And don't forget the Cessna flight.
Yes, and he flies on a plane now and then, right?
No, he takes a family.
He takes a family on a plane, yeah.
On the opening of an airport.
So the point is that McIntosh then decides to take it out on his father by demoting him and transferring him away from a better plantation to a less important one. And so the young Philip then sees discrimination happening at one level, but he also sees Malaysia's changing, and that in a sense that Malaysia now is not the same Malaysia. The Malays that were, you know, there was a secular country under Tunku Abdul Rahman at independence, and that secularism is being chipped away and being eroded by a rising Malay Muslim entity, a social structure, which now decides to suppress and depress some of the Chinese and the Indians, who were the minority communities. So the family, what does it do? Philip's parents now decide to resettle, you know, head back to Kerala to get away from this kind of discrimination.
Can I interject?
Yes.
It was not only that, it was also the Vietnam War. Don't forget. I mean, you are a specialist in that. My father had already saw that during Kennedy's time, that things were going to happen under Mao Zedong. And Ho Chi Minh had collaborated, and my father had predicted that the whole of Southeast Asia would end up in communism. So that was another factor. So he put all that into the mix. It wasn't a big decision for them to uproot and end up in Kerala. Yeah, sorry.
No, that's fine.
I just wanted to make the point.
Yeah, thanks for that. And so if I might just bring in a little bit of my own experiences in Singapore, was that the company I worked for in Singapore was the Straits Times group of newspapers. Our offices were full of Malaysian Chinese and Malaysian Indians. Yeah. Some of whom had actually left Malaysia. They decided that this was not the country for them because this was no longer a secular country. And the bulk of them had migrated with family en masse to Australia. And there was it was favored for some reason. They've also had gone away to England. So to come back to the book itself, the young Philip finds that in 1969, there are these very, very violent Muslim versus Chinese race riots which changed the destiny of both Singapore and Malaysia. So the riots were that there was brewing resentment from the Malay-Muslim larger majority community against the extremely prosperous and more intelligent, in a sense, more intellectually better equipped Chinese and Indians. So there was that happening there. So all of this would conspire to lead the young Philip to decide that, you know, he wasn't doing excellently in, he wasn't doing as well in studies as he'd like to, because he was more focused in badminton. So, and he didn't want to burden his papa by asking him for a lot of money. So he's so enterprising that he actually lands a job in England as a psychiatric nurse. And this is where I end my take. So he's off to the UK, and he doesn't come back to his country for 16 years. He doesn't come back to Malaysia. But the Malaysia that he left would never be the same again. Both physically, the kampongs were going, the construction pace was, you know, wherever he saw an old village, it wasn't there. If he looked at an old school building, bunch of them, they'd gone. And the social structure too had become, you know, Malaysia had this thing called the Bhumi Putra policy, which meant that the Bhumi Putra, the son of the soil, which favored the Malay, indigenous Malay, and it did not favor. You might want to talk a little bit about that.
Analogy, when I was growing up, so you could say, in many ways, I wanted to be an Uncle Tom, using that phrase. We're not allowed to use that in England, by the way, because it's quite racist. It comes from the kill the mockingbird, all that scenario from the slavery angle. But for ease of reference, I'm using that. So I wanted to be like them. So I was straight, although I would watch Tamil films, which came to the estates once every Thursday, I was exposed to all English films. You know, Clint Eastwood and Rolf Richardson and John Gielgud, Laurence Olivier, and all this sort of people. Serious films, black and white. And then it was Technicolor. Now, before Technicolor, it was Cinecolor. Technicolor. As I see, in the Asian countries, the parents tend to micromanage their children. Academia. And you know, when I go to Indian people's houses, England, the States, Australia, to Malaya, as soon as I say I'm from England, the first thing they want to, they're not even listening to me. They interject and saying, oh, I've got a son in so-and-so place, and he's doing an MBBS, and all that crap, I call it, because it's so vulgar. It's like saying, I've got a pay packet of $500,000, or I've got the biggest television in the house, or I drive a BMW. You know, it's so embarrassing. We don't do that in the West. We are very discerning, and we are not so loud. So I've been getting all this sort of stuff, and I understand why they're doing it. I don't mean to criticize, because they're very proud. They're first-line immigrants, come back from very social, downward sections, made good. They want their children to be better than them, no different to my father. You know, I love my father now because he's given me the discipline. But that is very good. And I think India is probably academically the best in the world. Nobody can compete with us in medicine. Even in space travel shortly, we will excel. But the left side of the column is missing, as I see it, because the left-hand side is education. So it's a bookkeeping entry, the left side consists of everything to do with leisure. And leisure can be subdivided into sports, travel, arts, films, whatever you want to do. And England, especially after the Second World War, they were released, and all the youngsters, there was so much energy going on in the late 50s. And the black music from B.B. King and people was coming from the South, Charlie Parker and all the jazz people you'll know about. The names escape me. I'm getting a senile moment. And then, ironically, they were ignored in America. A bunch of English guys decides they love it, like Eric Clapton was brought up on the blues. And so that music ended in the middle 60s. I'm growing up in Malaya, not knowing much about it. I knew about pop music, not about rock music, big distinction. So when I got to England, the Beatles was very important to my life. And John Lennon, I absolutely adore him. John Lennon, Che Guevara, and Bob Dylan are my...
three stars.
Not mentors as such. I don't have mentors. Yeah. I like the message and I like the naughtiness. Because I'm a naughty guy. I grew up naughty. So, you know, so it's stuff like that which assimilated my life in Kuala Lumpur. I just transported it to England to a slightly higher level. But badminton was the key which opened everything. So the badminton gave me amazing amount of confidence. And all my English friends would take me to that rock music to see Fleetwood Mac. The best guitarist, Richard Green, who died of drugs, Jimi Hendrix, the Woodstock Festival, 1969, I was in Malaya. I would hitchhike from Lancaster just to London, which is 500 kilometers one way, just to see a movie, and then hitchhike back. It's crazy things like that I would do. So the craziness is what's made me. But I didn't know I was doing crazy stuff. I just did it. You know, if I had to start work at 6 o'clock and I got home at 4 o'clock in the morning, I only had 2 hours sleep. I didn't make a big deal of it. Just got on with it.
Also, I think what occurs to me as a reader is that you make it very clear that if you were under parental control, micromanaged, you were not going to be yourself.
Yeah. Well, I was lucky because my parents had gone to Kerala, left me alone in Malaysia, and from there I ended up in England. So it's total freedom. You know, and I was a reasonably good-looking boy, I think, and I had groupies, 60, 70 females, wanting to watch me play badminton.
You were wicked.
I just wanted to say that if you read the book, I'm sure a lot of you will, it's like a progression of names. I've really forgotten whether it's Janet A, Janet B, Leslie, Alison. Yeah. So quite colorful, as Julie said, naughty boy. And I just want to give very quick, I think time's almost up, very quick random thoughts, a few of them. You know, reading this book is like reading, almost like reading a picaresque novel. I don't mean as in the similarity with the protagonist. He's not quite that bad. Quite good, in fact, but it's episodic. You know, you go from country to country, Olympics, games, matches, legal cases, marathons. So there's so much happening. And the other thing I wanted to mention is, just as there was this really harsh school teacher, it's so easy to almost destroy your spirit. He got caned in public for something really small, a transgression that didn't merit anywhere near that. And that could have scarred him for life. But I think it spurred him on to appreciate and savor success when he tasted it. But on the other hand, the wonderful image is that of his mother. And I think that is one of the warmest carrybacks from this book. The relationship with his mother, the fact that she always understood, she always encouraged. And also she herself, it was so easy for her without being able to speak the language, without being familiar at all with the culture across the continent, to get on, to understand, to throw herself into the life her son had made and to be happy. Something that possibly his father would have found difficult to do. I think we are almost at the end. I could say a lot more, but I'll hand it over
to
Julie.
Thank you, Indrila. I'll have Geeta, the co-author, give us the last word, and then would be very happy to hear your views.
Sorry to distract a little bit, because as a Malaysian, I feel I need to say this for the record. Yes, my country is facing challenges. Yes, there are discriminatory policies that are leading to a lot of divisiveness and mischief among the races in the country. But having said that, if you remove the politicians from the picture, the people on the ground remain hopeful, remain largely united, and remain spirited more than anything. Just wanted to make mention of that here.
Here, here.
Of course, we all want to remove politicians.
Thank you, Geeta.
And sorry, and so on that note, yeah, going back to this book, there's also resonance to what I said just now, which is we are functioning on coming out of failures. Yes, we are surrounded by failures. We are surrounded by failing policies, failing politicians. But like in this book, yeah, what's been my biggest takeaway from the book, from the stories, and from the man is that this is a man who has actually understood the power of failure and who has somehow formulated his own ways to rise from failure. So that is also what's happening in my country. That's also happening as Racket Boy searches for his country. And I would like to end on that note. Thank you.
Thank you, Geeta. Thank you so much. Abide my faith. That's the last message in the book. And that's my last message to you. So let's abide the faith and shoot wherever you have a question. Go ahead.
Hi.
Can you give us your name?
Avi.
Lovely.
Okay. So before I ask my question, I'd like to draw everyone's attention to the setting in front of us, especially the portrait that's in front of us. As you can see, there's the ships traveling in. We are in the company of those who have traveled great distances. All of these pictures, they're people who have traveled great distances in search of fortune, in search of opportunity, just like Philip has done so and Geeta has done so. So I find this setting to be most germane to the discussion we're having at hand. And I would like to extend my kudos to Mona and to Shush for the excellent choice of venue. Now on to the question. Philip and Geeta, I have a lot to ask you. For example, your perspectives on third culture children, Philip's life in England during the heyday of the British National Front, Geeta's opinion on Prime Minister Mahathir Mohamad, migration, as the gender differences of migration as it differs for men and women. So it's clearly I have a lot of questions, but
choose your favorite question and answer.
I'll stick to one question. How do you stay grounded when the grounds beneath you are constantly shifting? This question is very personal for me. In hotel room after hotel room and airport lounge after airport lounge, I've asked myself that question. I struggle to find my soul when everything's in flux. I hunger in that state of being the perpetual other for stability, for centeredness. So Philip and Geeta, you've likely experienced what I've described. How have you navigated this? To repeat my question, how have you stayed grounded when the grounds beneath you are constantly shifting? Thank you.
Thank you so much for that question. Geeta, will Philip try and answer that first?
Yeah, I think I'll try. Throughout my life, I don't sit there and analyze anything. It just comes, I face it. I don't like England. I'm jumping ship. Something happens in my head. and then I sleep on it perhaps, and then something surfaces, I'm going to live in Tuscany. I can do it because there's freedom of movement, because we're in the European Union. So with a British passport, I can just go and buy a house. So I was approaching 50 years of age. My pension lump sum was coming into play, and there was tax breaks. Mm. So I was already getting disillusioned. So in answer to your question, I'm on shaky grounds. So rather than sit in England and complain, which most people do, I had a gift wrapped and came from heaven, the tax break Gordon Brown brought in. So there was a device called SIPS, which allowed me to buy that house in Tuscany at a very tax-efficient way, which basically, in the end, cost me one-third of what it should be. So it was a no-brainer, plus my knowledge as a lawyer. I've been practicing for 40 years already. So I'm a cross-border jurisdiction lawyer, and I follow what's going on. So a bit of hope to it, bit of optimism, and then go get. And then stay the course. Stay the course. The coach I talked about, that candle, keep in the zone. And then efficiency of purchasing that property or whatever you're going to do. You're going to be a chef, same procedure. So it all starts with the word hope, which you talked about. So from hope, you know, your dream and your hope is there. My dream was to jump ship. And it was a difficult decision because I was doing extremely well economically, earning substantial amount of income, and also the gravitas as a lawyer. You know, I had people to fetch and carry for me. I never went to the bank for 20 years. My secretary went to the bank. Oh, I rang the bank manager, I want a loan for $500,000. Approved, Phil. I mean, that's pretty cool, yeah? I threw all that away and went to Italy, where I have to start all over again at the age of 60. So I'm on shaky grounds now. But I don't analyze it, and I've been okay.
Just do it.
So I can't really answer with a formula, if that makes sense. Yeah, thank you.
Geeta, and then Professor Arundhati Ray. Who's got the mic?
There.
Okay, will you give it to the professor, please? Thank you.
No, I had to come because I find, being a little personal here, a lot of resemblance with his life, interest in sports, because my husband went through the same. And I asked him this evening, would you like to come? He's a badminton guy. You might be able to chat with him a lot. He's not feeling too well. He's had two operations. And you had mentioned about squash. You played squash, right?
Yes, I did.
Yes.
To a high level.
Yeah, and my husband did also until the day he collapsed. That was very sad. But I don't know, it's so much of badminton, and I was always told you are good for nothing. You've never played sports in your life. But my point is, you know, after all this, when you land up in hospitals every other year, suffering operations. But a fantastic, I mean, I'm going to pick up your book and go just to present it to him, because he'll be able to correlate a lot of how he spent time there. And then, of course, Tuscany is absolutely top of the world. Mm. You cannot complain about Tuscany at all, I'm afraid. So you made the right choice. Thank you so much for a wonderful discussion today.
I just wanted to say one thing. The irony of this book, I know we've talked about prejudice, racial prejudice, etc., etc. But the irony is that there is an Indian origin PM, I know you've been very critical of him, who's ruling in the UK, who's taking some very tough decisions that not today, but maybe 10 years down the line, is going to be seen in perspective. Yeah.
Yeah. Question to Mr. Philip. Two questions, actually. The plantation owners were English or Scottish, actually?
Good question.
Because most of the business people, like tradesmen in India and in America, southern plantation owners, they were not English, they were Scottish. And number two question was the Malayan Communist Party. Why did it basically fizzle out? Was it because it was limited to the Chinese minority and the majority Malayan Muslim were not part of that movement? Or was it engineered, this division between the Chinese and the Malay Muslims, by the British colonial authorities?
Okay, there are two questions. I'll get Geetha to answer the second one, and then I'll answer the first one.
The Malayan Communist Party was a pretty serious movement in the entire Malayan Peninsula, including Singapore. But it was basically restricted to the Chinese community.
Yeah,
and
the
Malay Muslims were not part of that.
Correct.
Which is the majority, like overwhelming majority. So was that part of the weakness of that movement, why it fizzled out? And was this division between the Malay Muslims and the Chinese engineered by the British colonial authorities to basically, number one, suppress communism in Southeast Asia, and number two, to divide and rule as they did it in India?
Right. Geetha, I'll take over if you want.
Yeah.
I think I'll answer that one. When the Second World, the Japanese invasion happened, the British got a bloody nose, to put it mildly, because they were drinking gin and tonic and facing Blakan Mati, which is Sentosa Island, because it was Churchill thought, you know, they would be invincible, and these Japanese invaded. So the British then used the Chinese, they signed a declaration in Perak, in the forest, a very ad hoc agreement, where after the Second World War, in the event they defeated the Japanese, the British would then give power to the Chinese. And that was reneged upon by the English. And that brought about a guy called Chin Ping. And it was solely Chinese, supported by Mao Zedong. As I said earlier, with Vietnam, with Ho Chi Minh. So the Malays, the Kampong Malays, were excluded. They could not relate to it, and they were like the West Indian type in England, quite laid back people, bit of fish and a bit of rice, and you know, in their nice beautiful house, they were happy. The Indians, some of them Chandra Bose type of gang, would play a little bit of part on there. And then the Brits brought in the emergency from 57 up to 62. And it was divide and rule. So they put all the Chinese together in conurbations. And so those Chinese were told to hate the communist Chinese. So that's how it evolved. And of course, Chin Ping got lost. He lost. And then he ran away to Thailand or somewhere.
Southern Thailand.
And is he passed away now?
Yeah, he has.
Yeah. Sorry, this first part of your question was? Yes. That's another good question, because from the 18th century, 19th century, the people who worked in the rubber plantations were Etonians or Harrovians, high-class English. The lower-class English are the Irish and the Scottish. I don't like to generalize like that, but it's a theme. So McIntosh would be Scottish, and he would be appointed by Harrison and Crossfield, the trading company based in London. So they know who to appoint there. So he doesn't get too big for his boots. So my father's manager would be McIntosh. And often they are more racist than the refined Bloomsbury set, I call them, of the home counties. So to understand the English hierarchy, you need to follow me for a year. I will show it to you. In sport, in literature, you can see that in films. You can see that with Emma Thompson, Kenneth Branagh. You know, you can see that the whole lot. You can see that with BBC, ITV, and all this sort of stuff.
Well, there's some talk in academia that they learned it from us, our caste system.
Of course.
You can't beat that.
Yeah.
I'm kidding. Anyone else? Yes, please. Please, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm Ruma.
Hello there.
And my question to you, sir, is that it's really ironical that you sit in front of the portrait of the man who, like you, was a tinker, tailor, soldier, spy. You're literally the Renaissance man here. And I just want to know one small question that I have for you is that the capture of your book says the clueless immigrant. So for somebody who's so much, how do you get this very disarming, self-deprecating candor to call yourself clueless? I'd really like to know that.
Well, I'm still pretty clueless. You know, I just take every day as it comes. But what I do is, whatever I do it properly. So if I'm hitchhiking, I have a route. You know, if I'm cooking, I have a process. If I'm going running, I have a process. And Geetha will tell you this, the travel we are doing, we're on a 3-month tour around India. It's all about the process. So I suppose that's how I, and the other thing I told you earlier, it's a desire, hope, and a target. And as a sports person, you know, I've run so many marathons. The first marathon I wanted to run under 3 hours. So that is my target. So I suppose, in answer to your question.
So not so clueless after all.
Yeah, maybe.
So the carefully careless. I like the attitude. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I like this word yatra. You know, it's got to be there. So
again, this is me. I saw David Beckham put Sanskrit stuff on there. So that Sanskrit is very fashionable in the West.
Yeah.
So I thought, see, I just picked it like that. So there was no grand plan, if that means.
Well, you must have a plan with Armani, because you only love and wear minimalist Armani.
Yeah, I mean, that happens to be a label, that's all. But it's all about simple. Because, you know, I try to keep my life fairly simple in everything I do. So Armani represents simpleness.
Anyone else? Thank you, you've been a marvelous audience. It's absolutely amazing how much productivity we got in today and so many laughs. The books are at the back of the room. If you'd like to get a signed copy, this is your time. Thank you.
I just wanted to say this is Ahava's 54th book launch. So let's hear it for Ahava. And I think over 100 events that they've done. Mona and Shushrutha. Thank you everyone for being here.